Welcome to a long overdue edition of the Boxing Trade Show podcast with me and Greg. Today we'll be discussing the Benn Eubank fight. Is it going to happen? And the latest in the welterweight division worldwide. For this and more, take a listen. Cheers, guys. Right, a long overdue episode of the Boxing Trade Show. We'll remind you of our names. It's George Mallett over here and Greg Cooke over there. How are we doing, Greg?
Yeah, I'm all right, George. Thank you. Not so bad. Good to be back chatting. I know it's been, like say, overdue, hasn't it? We've not really caught up for a while, but it's always nice to jump back on and catch up when we can, mate. But yeah, really good. Thank you, mate. How are you?
Yeah, very well. Thanks, mate. I'm buoyed by hopefully a bit of positive news in the, I was going to say the welterweight division, but what division is it really? It's the news of the Suns fighting, isn't it? Essentially, Conor Benn against Chris Eubank Jr. What do you make of all that then?
I think it's 156, isn't it? So it's just slightly above light middle or super welter. And I was looking at it and I thought, I mean, I think Eddie Hearn's done an interview tonight. On Wednesday, saying that it's not fully signed yet, I don't think. So I think from what people are saying, it is close to being announced, but I'm all for it. I think the build-up's going to be massive. I think they've always kind of been on a collision course, but I always looked at it and thought, with Benn being at welterweight and at a time Eubank Jr. being at super middle when he fought in the World Boxing Super Series and DeGale, I thought there's no way they'll ever be able to fight unless Benn ever went up to middle or whatever. And I was looking at it thinking, well, Ben's got to go up in weight, but Eubank's got to come down. So you always favour the bigger man in a fight, but they're going to be both at a catch weight. So I don't think Eubank's ever fought at that weight before. I know he's fought a middle and super. So it's going to be, I think it's quite interesting. You'd always favour the bigger man. And so I'd have to, at this moment in time, say I favour Eubank. But really exciting. I think the build-up more than anything is going to be big and it'll capture the general public's imagination. And you're going to see Nigel Benn and Chris Eubank Senior probably going at it as well. They'll probably end up on the undercard or doing something daft, you know. I'm all for it, mate. And I think that it's probably the nostalgia of it that more than anything, you know, seeing the Benn Eubank names going at it. And it's a big fight for Benn. I know you look at Eubank, he's fought for world titles in the past. He's fought in the World Boxing Super Series. So I think if anybody's going to be overawed by it, I think you may look at Benn, but he doesn't seem like the person that would be. He's fought at the O2, he's fought in Manchester, he's been about. So I'm all for it, mate, I really am. The fact it's at a catch weight, it'll be interesting to see how it goes, really. I think it'll be closer than what people think, but at the minute, I favour Eubank, really.
Yeah, it seems to be that the last negotiations are all over that rehydration clause, aren't they? Seems to be that it will be at 156. It's just probably Eubank Jr. going to come in in the ring at. But yeah, I mean, it's interesting you say you're just leaning towards Eubank Jr. In my head, when it was announced or when they were talking about this, I thought this is 80-20, 90-20 in favour of Eubank Jr. I didn't really think it. I think we're talking about a man who's 5'11", and he's quite a big 5'11" as well. He fills out that. I know he's got to somehow get down to 156, but he always strikes me as quite a disciplined bloke. He's got down to 160 pretty easily. 4 pounds, admittedly, it's a decent chunk, but yeah, on paper, I was like, it seems like it could be a bit of a mismatch, but it's a shot to nothing for Conor Benn, isn't it? I mean, he loses nothing by going into that. No one's going to say, unless it's like Kell Brook going up to Golovkin and getting his eye socket smashed. He's got nothing to lose whatsoever. But if you didn't have that Benn Eubank Senior rivalry, which to be honest doesn't actually seem like much of a rivalry any longer, they're quite nice to each other nowadays.
Yeah.
If you didn't have that, you'd be thinking, what? So you're telling me Conor Benn wants to make himself look good, sort of middleweight. And so he's going to handpick a guy. The last person that you'd handpick, surely, if you've got punching power and technically you're a little bit weaker than some, you don't pick Chris Eubank Jr. Surely, if he's got anything, it's a chin. That's So it seems like a bit of an odd matchup in that respect, but it's pretty fascinating one, full stop. But yeah, 5'8", 5'11", does seem a bit of a big difference to me.
Yeah, I know what you mean. I think, you know, I mean, I was chatting to my brother about it. He was saying, you know, you look at Eubank Jr., you look at who he's been in with. And he's been in with Groves. He's been in with Billy Joe. He went on to become a 2-weight world champion. Groves, you know, Groves has been in with everybody, really. I said, yeah, pretty much everybody of that era. Froch twice, De Gale. He'd been in with Eubank. He'd been in with Badu Jack, Callum Smith. So I think Eubank's got that experience of fighting good level fighters, but he's never been stopped. That's one thing. But I know Benn can bang and Eubank's never been stopped, but he's taking that power up to above light middleweight. Effectively, you're going from 149 to 154, 156. You don't want it to look like it's, and I agree, if Benn was to lose, you'd go back down to welterweight and then you'd push on and try and make a world title charge, wouldn't you, through the WBA? You'd think, come back away from that. And, you know, there's no shame. But you don't want it to be like a circus act thinking, oh, we've just done it because of the dads and things like that. That's obviously going to play a part, but it's a big money fight. And you never know, they could do, if it's a good fight, they could fight again and they could do a trilogy. And it is things like that that does capture the imagination of the general public. It's just what Benn goes on to do after that. And I suppose the same with Chris Eubank Jr., because I look at that and I think, what's he going to do? Like, not legacy-wise, this could be legacy. Like, winning a world title and things like that, what weight class is he best at? Is he best at this weight that he's going to? Is he good at middleweight? He's never in a million years going to be Golovkin, Canelo, Andrade, Charlo at middle. I don't think he's got any, you know, if Canelo vacates the belt super middle, he might fight for a vacant title. But, and I'm not classing the WBA regular as a world title. You've got to look at it and think, if he comes away from this fight against Benn and wins, which I think he will, then he's got to start thinking, well, I need to fight someone to win a world title. Do you know what I mean? That's my only frustration with Chris Eubank Jr. You know, I know he's fought Groves for the world title, and granted, you've got to give him that credit, but since the Groves defeat, he's unbeaten. Doing this, you think, what's this doing for his career? Don't get me wrong, really excited about it. But when you think in the long term, you've been fighting a middleweight, you've come down to light middle to fight, and then you're going to go back up. What's the plan what's the plan again at middleweight? I don't know. With Benn, you know what if you lose, make a world title charge at welter. But with Benn, with Eubank, I wouldn't know what the plan would be after that fight. It's mad. But regardless of that, I'm well excited about it. And like you say, it captures the general public, the public's imagination. It'd just be interesting to see what happened, like you said, after that fight. What's next for him, you know?
Yeah. Well, I mean, Benn, Eubank Jr. doesn't seem like he's ever been that interested in just going sort of conventional ways for world titles. I mean, he was kind of, by Golovkin winning that fight against Murata, that kind of stuffed him in a way, because the Triple G, Canelo trilogy seemed like that was going to be made miles off. And it means that, obviously, Triple G's tied up for a little while, and I don't even think Chris Eubank Jr. has much interest in just trying to go for any of the sort of other world titles. I think like 1% of him, 1 to 5% of him, or maybe even more, thinks that he's already won a world title in winning the IBO. Genuinely think that some part of him probably does. But yeah, I agree. Where does he go? But there must be a lot of money on the table. That's all I'm saying.
I genuinely think, as a fighter, you've got to look at the money. You've got to think, you know, secure your future and your kids' future and things like that, and get a good bit of wealth behind you. And I think with him fighting on Sky, you'll earn good money. When he went to the World Boxing Super Series, he got to the semis, you'd have earned good money there. for De Gale, you know, he's probably done quite well for himself. And I remember when he was meant to sign to fight Golovkin and Kell Brook stepped up, so that didn't happen. And you just look at his record, and all right, Groves and Billy Joe Saunders, but he got beat. So it makes you think, well, if he was to go in with somebody like Golovkin, even Morata, Andrade, I know Canelo's more so super middle, Charlo, that is when he'd get stopped. That is when the stoppage would come, I believe, in his career. So he's got to really think about what he's doing next, I think, because I think with Sky, when he fought Liam Williams, you know, it was a regular fight now, but I bet he was being paid good money. So I bet he's looking at this thinking, I'm the bigger man. Rehydration clause isn't that bad. I'm going to smash him to bits. So that's what he'll be thinking. I think it'll be closer than what people anticipate, but I think just the bigger man will do better on the night. But I think he is probably sitting there. How old is he now? 32, 33?
32.
He's not getting any younger. So he's probably sitting there going, been in the game, got me faculties in check, earned some good money. You know, it's just what he does after the Benn fight. I think with Benn, it's quite clear, go back to welter, and I think this fight has to happen for their legacies and things, and they'll look back on it with good memories. But I think it'd be interesting, it really will, to see what Eubank does after that fight. Because like I said, I do favour the bigger man in it, you know. But I just hope he gets signed. Everyone's got, yeah, it's signed, it's this, it's that. I think Eddie, like I say, we've done an interview on Wednesday saying it's not yet signed, I don't think. But that's what's going to launch DAZN pay-per-view in a big way in the UK, I think.
Yeah. Well, DAZN seems to be suffering a little bit at the moment, doesn't it? I mean, the news that the Anthony Joshua fight, I think that was to like Wednesday, they said that'll be on Sky Sports pay-per-view. Probably not a massive surprise, but pretty big surprise considering the announcement that DAZN made a few weeks ago, a couple of months ago, about Joshua signing to DAZN. So it seems like a bit of an own goal there to not have him fighting. Probably, I mean, if he loses that fight, it's probably going to be the biggest fight that they'd have on the DAZN platform, because the other ones are going to be smaller going forward. But
I agree. And you know, when that all got released, he signed a multi-fight deal with DAZN. Brilliant. You know, then you're thinking, it's got to be on DAZN next. But what I think people are talking about is, I think the rights of the fight were sold to, you know, the people in Saudi Arabia. So they decided who got the money. I know it's being priced at $26.95, I think, isn't it? On Sky. And it might do all right, because there's interest in it. There's interest to see how he gets on. But announcing that he'd signed a multi-fight deal with them, and then it's, oh yeah, but that one isn't. That, like you say, that would have been the biggest one they could have done. So then you look at all the politics around it then. Will Eddie Hearn promote it because it's not on his platform? Not as much as he'd need to. Will that affect Joshua going into it, the promotion of it? I mean, when he comes back to DAZN and fights on there, if he was to lose to Usyk, the fight that will be made on DAZN pay-per-view will be Joshua White 2. Because they both be coming off losses. That'll be the fight that they make. White will probably have some time out and probably start next year. If he loses, I hope he wins, obviously. You know, you've got to back the Brit, but that'll be the fight that they'll make. And then they might do a trilogy and just, you know. But he's just the effect that he has on that undisputed fight, isn't it, with Tyson Fury? But he should have done that fight after the Kubrat-Pulev victory, but just seems a bit of a mess, to be honest. All of it, the heavyweight stuff, I was really into it at one stage, and now it just, all the politics of it, and does my head in, mate, honestly. It infuriates me, really does. But like you said, own goal, that announced, yeah, multi-fight deal. Oh, but his next fight's on, you know, didn't make sense, didn't add up somehow.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you now, I won't be paying for the fight, but I'll try and watch it somehow, but 27 quid for a... Probably watch Joshua get bashed up for 27 quid. I know some people would pay money to see that. They'd probably pay 27 quid, but yeah, it's a bit steep for me. But
I'll probably go out and watch it. Probably go and watch it. You know, see, yeah, just watching pub or something like that, I think. You know, you know, when you've got your subscription to DAZN, Sky, BT, you know, Box Nation, let's say people have still got that. It used to be one at $19.95, I think, or even $24.95 when Joshua was really up. I think Klitschko might have been that. I don't know, or the Ruiz fight, but $26.95, adding a couple of quid on it. You know, you look at it and you think, what's the point? But yeah, it'll be interesting how that fight goes and what changes Joshua makes going into it. But it doesn't seem to be that much, I'll be honest. What are we, a month away? And there isn't that much interest, I don't think. People haven't been ranting and raving about it. Compare that to the Fury White fight, even though White didn't even really want to turn up and promote it himself. That still did quite well. So comparing the two, who's got the star power now? Mad, mate. But like I say, the heavyweight stuff just infuriates me. They're all... I just wanted to see Fury Joshua so bad. And yeah, politics of boxing just ruins it, doesn't it? Ruins it.
Does indeed. But anyway, we'll see that one day on free TV, the Joshua Fury fight. We'll get that for free. So
maybe we'll get free tickets as well. Yeah, free tickets.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. But
hell freeze over before that happens, George.
Yeah, I don't think you'll be the only one. But yeah, we've got, let's skip with the if, buts, and maybes. We've got a pretty big definitive, and that is a DAZN fight involving Michael McKinson against Virgil Ortiz. No world title on the line. They're all sort of sewn up with Spence and Crawford, aren't they? Spence is hogging the WBC, IBF, and WBA. And then you've got Crawford with the WBO. But both McKinson and Ortiz are ranked pretty highly in, a couple of different belts. I think we got WBC, Ortiz is 2, WBO, Ortiz 1, WBA, Ortiz 1. And then you've got McKinson at 5 in the WBO and 10 in the WBA. So the winner of this fight, you would think, they might have to wait a little bit if Spence Crawford does get made, but you would think that they would be first in line for the next world title shot. But yeah, what do you make of that matchup? It's a bold one from McKinson, isn't it?
Big, big statement. And because I know they were met a fight, was it a couple of months ago when it got called off? Didn't know if Ortiz was injured or he was unwell, something like that. But the way you look at Virgil Ortiz Jr. and Boots Ennis in America, the way that they're being built up is the next Spence and Crawford, really. They're going to be the next best things in the welterweight division. Because it is a blue ribbon division, isn't it? The welterweight, middleweight, you know, heavyweights, they're quite lightweights along with them. They're quite a prestigious weight class, and especially in America, they really push them. And Virgil Ortiz Jr. and Boots Ennis down the line, that would be a great fight. But going back to McKinson, brave. I think he's 22-0 or 18-20-0. WBO Global, I think, champ or something like that. So I know, I remember you saying he's quite high with the WBO. Virgil Ortiz is a good, you know, he's a good fighter. He's, like I say, up-and-comer, and he's going in with McKinson. I remember you saying he's done it the hard way, hasn't he? He's been on small all shows. And this fight on its own will change his life. His exposure, who he is, the money that he'll make. If he wins that fight, I'm assuming there'll be a rematch because there normally is, because he's not going to be the favourite. But if he wins that fight, he changes his life. And he's a tricky customer, McKinson. But he's been a tricky customer at a certain level. But then again, Virgil Ortiz hasn't been tested at elite world level yet. So it has a really good dynamic, I think. They've both been tested at certain levels. Both, I suppose, differing styles. I'm quite excited for that fight. And I'm hoping it's on. Is it August the 8th?
August the 8th. 6th.
Next Saturday. I mean, if I'm not, I might try and stay up for that. Because like I said, I do subscribe to DAZN. So I may try and stay up and watch that. Because I'm quite interested to see how McKinson gets on. He's tricky and he's a good, good boxer. Hit and not get hit. And it'll be interesting to see how Ortiz manages with that and deals with it. But yeah, quite excited. And it'll be interesting to see how that goes. But Virgil Ortiz, 18 wins, 18 by KO. Most notable victories for me, I'd probably say Maurice Hooker, Samuel Vargas.
Yeah, then I mean, the Hooker one is not, I mean, I think that was right after the, well, not right after, it might have been two fights after he lost to Jose Carlos Ramirez.
Yeah. And he'd kind of dipped then, hadn't he? Yeah.
But I mean, he's still, he, and it, I think that must have been, was that one of his first fights up at welterweight? Must have been.
Hooker's, yeah, because he was a lightweight, wasn't he?
Yeah.
And I remember Hooker, he beat Flanagan and then he moved up. I mean, he might have just gone straight up to welter from lightweight, which is mental. There's no in-between with the super lightweight stuff. So, again, big statement from Hooker going in and fighting him. He's never a welterweight Hooker, I don't think. So it's, you look at who he's for, and Samuel Vargas, Conor Benn's fought Samuel Vargas, knocked him out in the first round. So you kind of look at it and think, and I'm not trying to sit here and say Virgil Ortiz isn't as good as what people are saying, but look at who he's been with. They're the two best names on his record. So it's going to be, and you've got to look at Samuel Vargas, end of his career, potentially. Hooker moving up two weight classes to fight him. I think McKinson's got a shout. I'm throwing it out there. I think McKinson's got a shout. Good luck to him.
Mate, I don't think you're the only one. I think it's a weird one. You, like, as you say, 18 fights, 18 KOs, fought some decent fighters, the golden boy, fighting in his home. He's fighting in Texas. He lives in Texas. Everything's against McKinson. But considering a Brit going abroad to America, I've never seen a more sort of like confident team going out there. Yeah. Considering, I think McKinson's had 22 fights. He's had two knockouts. And a lot of those 22, you can probably say that until he fought Chris Congo, there wasn't really, they were all small hall shows until he got that chance and beat Chris Congo. But he's a man who's at every level stepped up, and we just don't really know what level he's at yet. I think it's massively telling that Avanesyan seemed to dodge this fight. I don't know. I know that Neil Marsh was saying that it wasn't quite as simple as that, but he didn't ever seem to give a real valid reason why they didn't really take the fight.
Was that with McKinson, was it? Was that with McKinson?
Sorry. It was Avanesyan against Ortiz. So that was, before McKinson got agreed the first time, it was all Avanesyan against Ortiz. And then that broke down and, yeah, Neil Marsh got a lot of flack for it.
Well, when you dig it out to, you know, Conor Benn, for example, saying you're not fighting Avanesyan, you get an opportunity to then fight Ortiz in a big money fight, because Avanesyan's quite well known. That's a good fight, that is. And you don't take it, then glass houses, isn't it? You know, you shouldn't throw stones. So, yeah, that's another story, isn't it? But I agree, mate. I'm quite excited for that fight and just wish McKinson the very best, because he's proven he's a good boxer. And, you know, he's just got, like you said, he's got to go in full of confidence and really kind of try and take it to him. And yeah, quite excited for that. Wish him all the very best of luck with it.
Yeah. Hit and not get hit. I think that's the plan for McKinson. But if he switches off for a second, he's not a nice guy to be in the ring with.
No, exactly.
Yeah, we will see. But in terms of the welterweight landscape, besides that Spence's win over Ugas has kind of paved the way for what should be that fight. But how many years have we probably said that Spence Crawford is, surely it's the next logical one? I think that's all gone quiet a little bit. Do you think that the next fight for the pair of them will be against each other?
Probably not. I think there's big talk about it. I'd love it because they're fighting when they're both like in, you could, well, they are, they're in their primes, really. They are. Now is the perfect time for them to, because that'll be an unbelievable fight. All the belts are on the line. They're both in their prime, both American. It makes perfect sense, and it does so well, especially in America. But that's a massive fight. And that, besides Fury Joshua and Canelo Golovkin, Canelo Golovkin's happening. Fury Joshua's an age away, if it ever happens. Just jump on it now. Do two or three fights if you have to. Crawford, if I'm Crawford, you're signing with PBC on a two-fight deal. Just get it done. Or, you know, remain as a free agent and fight how you want. But he's not going to get the money anywhere else. I don't know who's going to be difficult in this. I think Spence has every right to feel he's the A-side. So he's got three world titles, big name. Crawford, however, is a former undisputed world champion. He's a three-weight world champion. So, yeah, they've just got to sit and make that fight. I don't think it happens next. I think Spence will fight somebody like Keith Thurman, someone like that. And I think Crawford may go and, I don't know, fight somebody else in the interim just to build it even further. But then again, who would Crawford go and fight? Danny Garcia or someone like that, or Ugas? Well, is Ugas retired? I think he has, hasn't he? Yeah.
Well, I know Manny Pacquiao is obviously retired, isn't he? Ugas, he might have done with that, to be honest. He's not that relevant any longer. I know that sounds brutal, but I mean,
yes. So it'd be pointless in fighting him, wouldn't it? I mean, I suppose, but then again, like Spence Thurman, people would buy into it because it's Spence. With Crawford fighting Ugas, I agree, it's different, isn't it? But I don't know, I just find it mental if that fight, he's not with Top Rank and Bob Arum anymore, so what's stopping it from happening? That's the mad thing for me. But seeing that fight and getting it made, that it gives you that extra hope that boxing's still got something to offer. The big fights can still be made. You can still see the best fighting the best. People who watch boxing as a casual, you think why on earth don't these fights get made? But that'd be, if we got to see that, I'd be very, very happy, because you've seen them both in the prime, undisputed, Ring Magazine on the line. I just hope they do, but I can't see it for whatever reason. I really can't. You get your hopes up, don't you? And then it, you know.
Well, anyway, if it doesn't get made, then chief in line is the winner of Ortiz against McKinson. So, yeah, that's a fight to get excited about. Someone who's still kicking around in the welterweight division, you probably hear about him more for things outside the ring than in it. But we've got another fight for Adrian Broner coming up. I think 20th of August against Omar Figueroa. And I think Figueroa's most recent fights are against your Dennis Ugas. And he was stopped last time out against Abel Ramos. And then Broner's obviously got those sort of, he had that run where he kind of unraveled a little bit and seems to be back in the ring, whether that's because he's short of a few bob or because he's cleaned up his act, remains to be seen. But do you think there's any place for Adrian Broner in that division going forward? Or
It's nice to see that he's back on the straight and narrow. You know, because you see all sorts of things on social media, and he's, you know, it's mad because people find it funny, and it's sad, really. He's gone off the rails quite a few times, and his outbursts as well. And I think when he started out, you know, the interest in Broner was big. I think people were really looking at him like people look at Tank now. I think people were actually looking at Broner like the next Mayweather. And then when he got beat by Maidana, and he was so disrespectful to Maidana. I remember that so well. And I was, just because of how disrespectful he was, I was really pleased that Maidana won that fight. And after that, it's just kind of really been up and down, really. You know, I know he's been a world champion and things like that, but I still think he's got a lot to offer. Do I think he's got any chance against Spence and Crawford? Zero. Could he still be in interesting fights against Thurman and people like that? Potentially. Might say if he cleans his act up and really goes for it. But then I think in time, if he ever wanted to have a dream and an aspiration of winning a world title again, then that's when you'd look at light middle. I think if Charlo was to move up in weight from light middle to middle, and again, belts become vacant, then you could build him again. You know, imagine Broner against Castano, or I don't know, Broner against Liam Smith, something like that. There's interest there again. Even I'm thinking about that now, thinking, that's quite interesting. So, yeah, fights such as Thurman, if he went in with Spence and Crawford, I don't think he's got a chance, but, you know, well, if he was to get his gone.
I was gonna, Fred, what about Conor Benn next?
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, because it, but I look at the Conor Benn fight and I think that that's a big name for Benn. That benefits Benn much more than it does Broner. I don't think Broner's ever been stopped, has he? I'm pretty certain he's never been stopped.
No. No, it's
never. So, if Benn was to go in there and make a statement and stop him at welter, but it's just how much, what faculties he's got at welter anymore, you know, Ben's young and fresh and could really put it on him. I'd like, I, if I was to see him, don't get me wrong, I'd like to see it. It's big for Conor Benn. It's big, especially welterweight. But I just, I look at, I think just seeing him well again and seeing him in the ring is a positive. Someone against, like someone like Figueroa, you know, he probably, hopefully won't get hurt. And, you know, depends how well he's trained for the fight. But I think regardless of if he's got a place in the welterweight division, I think boxing sometimes, you need characters, don't you? And I think he's just got a place in boxing. It's nice to see him back. And, you know, you always know you're going to get, you're always going to get fireworks at the press conference, let alone fight. I have a soft spot for Broner and it's nice to see him back. And like I say, if he could push on and light middleweight and become a two-weight world champion then. Because he fought, did he fight a super lightweight before welterweight? So he might already be a two-weight world champion. Second guessing myself here, George.
I couldn't tell you.
I'm going to have a look.
Super lightweight, he won a world title.
He's not won one at welter, has he?
He has won at what? He has won at, well, he's won super lightweight, lightweight, and he won the WBA world welter against Mallett. So, technically,
four. He's done it in four. What? That's battered my head. WBO super feather, WBC lightweight, WBA welter, and WBA light welterweight.
It's not bad, is it?
No, it isn't. And how many fights is he had? Just look at, I thought that was going to, he's had 40 fights. Like, genuinely, that's battered my head. I had no idea. He's a four-weight world champion, Broner. Well, I've learned something new tonight, George.
Yeah. Well, that's got to be, probably on that bombshell, I think we've probably got to call it a day because despite our high budget, we're running out of time on the old Zoom, aren't we? So
yeah, we are, mate, yeah.
Pleasure as always, Greg. I'm looking forward to those fights we just talked about. And yeah, we'll catch up in, hopefully, fingers crossed, a couple of weeks.
Absolutely, mate. Yeah, we've got to keep it going, mate. Like I say, it's always nice when we catch up and things getting, you know, life happens, doesn't it? But we've got to keep it up. And like I say, always a pleasure, mate. Great to chat to you. And yeah, like I say, looking forward to them fights coming up. Because, yeah, lovely chat to you, George. Like I say, I'm sure we'll catch up soon, mate.
Yeah, brilliant. Take care, Greg.
Cheers, George. Speak to you soon.